In this video, we'll compare Python and Go in Kubernetes. Specifically, we'll use Django framework for Python and compare it with Go standard library. We'll measure CPU usage and memory usage of each application. We'll also measure availability, which is the percentage of time application is available for use. Additionally, we'll measure CPU throttling as we're deploying our applications to Kubernetes. We'll also measure network pressure, focusing on how many bytes each application receives and transmits each second. One of the most important metrics in this test is latency. We'll measure P99 latency from the client side. Finally, we'll generate enough load to find the breaking point for each application. You might be surprised, but memory in Golang plays a huge role when application is under heavy load. To run the first test, I created a simple endpoint for both applications /API/devices, which returns a hard-coded device in JSON format. To make it easier for Python to serialize, instead of creating a class for the device, I used a Python dictionary and built-in Django function to serialize that dictionary to JSON and return it to the client. On the Go side, I created a device struct, and since I used the standard library, I have a render JSON function that serializes Go struct to JSON and returns it to the client. Now, the second test is a bit more interesting and simulates a common use case. Our application will read the file from the local file system and upload that file to S3 bucket, then saves some metadata about that file to a relational database, in our case Postgres. To monitor it, I instrumented both applications with Prometheus metrics to measure each function call, and we'll measure P99 percentile to visualize it in the Grafana. We'll measure how long it takes to upload the file to S3 bucket and how long it takes to insert new data to Postgres. We'll also run the test until both applications fail. First, let's take a look at Django. It's a very popular web framework that many companies use. It allows you to quickly and easily create web applications. For example, most applications need some kind of persistence layer, such as a database. With Django, you simply create a Python class that inherits from Django model, and that's it. Based on this small class, Django will generate the necessary SQL migrations and create corresponding database table, so you never need to write SQL queries directly. If you need to change the database table or add a column, you just modify the Python class and run migration that Django generates for you. In our case, we have image class that would create this database table. In your Python code, you can create this image instance just like any other Python class using init method and default constructor. When you need to save this image to the database, you simply call save method and that's it. There is no need to manually create or execute SQL queries. Everything is abstracted for you. Django also comes with admin application that you can use to manage your website. For example, you can use UI to create an image or, in another case, a blog post. You can create a view and add articles through the admin panel. And the best part is that it's automatically updated based on the same Python class you created for your model. Additionally, there are many other ready-to-use middleware and applications like authentication, session management, and many others. The biggest selling point of this framework is that you can very quickly create a fully functional web application that includes everything, even user management. Now, if you like me and deploy everything to Kubernetes, you generally have two options with Django migrations. The easiest approach is to use init containers, which ensures that your database is up to date every time you deploy application to Kubernetes. You can run all migrations this way, or you can target specific migrations when you deploy a new version. If you need more control over migrations, you typically create a Kubernetes job and manually deploy it before upgrading your Django application. This gives you a bit more control. On the other hand, I'll be using Go standard library to create a simple web application. Since Go 1.21, you no longer need a framework like Jin, Echo, or Fiber to create REST application. The standard library has everything you need. In both Python and Go cases, we'll be using official AWS SDKs to upload files to S3. And the most popular Postgres drivers. So far, I've got a lot of pull requests to improve Go application, but I won't include all of them in this test. I want to use default configurations as much as possible, and I'll link pull requests with additional Go optimizations in the video description. Let's go ahead and start. For each test, I provision a new EKS cluster, and you can do the same if you follow my tutorial. I'm using extra large instances to run applications. For generating load, I'm using Graviton 4 extra large instances. Additionally, I'm using 8 extra large instances to deploy Minio, which is open source object store with the same API as S3. I also deploy Postgres on the same node. Now, let me deploy both applications to Kubernetes and run them for about 5 to 10 minutes to get a baseline. I've set resource requests and limits for the pods so that each application only gets 2 virtual CPUs and 512 megabytes of memory. You'll notice that Python uses a little more CPU and significantly more memory, but the two applications use memory differently under load, which you'll see soon. Looking at the actual memory usage in bytes, Django uses around 188 megabytes, and the Go application uses about 22 to 25 megabytes. Alright, let me deploy Kubernetes jobs to start the test and generate load. I'll deploy 5 pods for each application and increase the number of virtual clients every 20 seconds until both applications start to fail. Even at the start, you can see that Python uses much more CPU to process requests compared to Go. As expected, Golang's latency is under 1 millisecond, but Python, even without a significant load, takes more than 2 milliseconds. As we continue, you'll notice that around 2500 requests per second, the Python application reaches about 60% CPU usage, and latency begins to rise. For this application, I would recommend keeping CPU usage below 50%. To avoid a poor user experience. You can also see Kubernetes starts to throttle Django application, which adds additional latency. For this test, I also monitored network usage. On one side, we measure how much data our application transmits each second. Since Django adds more headers and sends them over the network, it's expected that Python transmits more data. However, it's not entirely clear why Django application receives more data, given that I'm using the same clients and both applications receive the same number of requests. It could be due to TCP handshake, but if you know what's causing this, please let me know. At this point, Python application clearly fails and can't process more requests. So I'll increase the number of Go clients from 5 to 35 to generate additional load. So far, Django can handle between 3000 and 4000 requests per second. If you saw my previous Rust benchmark, you'll recall that Rust handled around 160,000 requests per second with the same setup, which is a significant difference. Let's see how many requests Golang can process. We'll slowly increase the load until Golang starts to degrade. At this point, Python is heavily throttled by Kubernetes, resulting in high latency. Python doesn't cache any requests and maintains stable memory usage, which will be important shortly. Golang's memory usage is also relatively stable. At around 57,000 requests per second, Kubernetes starts to throttle Go application, and we can expect latency to increase soon. You'll also notice Golang's memory usage starts to rise because it begins caching many of the requests. At around 70,000 requests per second, Kubernetes throttles Golang even more, which is about the maximum number of requests per second that Golang can handle. At this point, CPU usage is close to 100%, and memory usage rapidly increases. Unlike Python, which slows down but doesn't cache requests, Golang does, and it eventually hits 100% memory usage. When memory reaches 100%, the pod is immediately OM-killed and rescheduled, as memory is not elastic like CPU and cannot be throttled. The Golang pod has now reached 100% memory usage and has been killed. If you missed it, you can describe the pod, and in the exit field, you'll see OM killed. Let's take a look at the graphs for the entire test duration. First, we have requests per second graph, which shows a significant difference in the number of requests each application can handle. Next is the latency graph. I'll also compare latency before both applications started to degrade. There is a huge difference here as well. Next, we have CPU usage. Then memory usage. Availability graph. CPU throttling. Network receive usage. Let me also show the interval before I increased the number of Go clients. Finally, we have network transmit usage. That's all for the first test. Let's start the second test, where applications will read the files from the local file system, upload them to S3 bucket, and save metadata about that file to a Postgres relational database. In addition, we'll measure S3 latency and database latency, specifically how long it takes to insert data into Postgres. I'm also using Prometheus Postgres exporter to monitor how many connections each application establishes with the database. Both applications using connection pool with default settings. For the first few minutes, you'll notice that Python's insert latency is lower, but as we reach 15 requests per second, it starts to increase. The same applies to S3 latency, which is significantly higher for the Python application. You'll also notice that Golang uses a smaller connection pool, slowly increasing from 1 to 4 connections. At around 25 requests per second, Kubernetes starts to throttle Django application. At around 40 requests per second, Python begins to degrade. At this point, it even fails to save any more data to Postgres, and soon after, availability drops to zero. Let's continue running the test for a few more minutes. The maximum number of requests Golang can handle is around 100 requests per second. After that, for some reason, database latency increases and application becomes unavailable. I have not debugged this yet, but if you know what's going on, please let me know. Alright, let's take a look at each graph. First, we have requests per second. Then, client latency. Next, CPU usage. Memory usage. S3 latency. Database latency. Availability. Number of database connections. Network receive usage. Network transmit usage, which is well below the network throughput limit for this instance type. Finally, we have CPU throttling. If you know how to improve Django application, please create a pull request. You'll find links in the video description, including how to run Postgres and Minio locally for testing. I have other benchmarks you might find interesting. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.